depressurized in space with less than 20 seconds to react while descending back to Earth. These three cosmonauts were caught in history's most horrific disaster to occur in space. What started as a carefully coordinated mission ended in pure horror. What happened next is truly disturbing. On June 29, 1971, aboard Salyut 1, the world's first orbiting space station, Georgy Dobrovolsky, Vladislav Volkov, and Viktor Pastayev were preparing to return home after 22 days of scientific experiments and undocked from the station, ready to re-enter the Earth's atmosphere. But while the USSR celebrated their historic mission back on Earth with controlled television broadcasts, the crew was about to make history for a much darker reason. They only had 4 days' notice before launch because a key member of the original crew was believed to have tuberculosis. As the backup team, two were in space for the first time, leading to clashes between Commander Dobrovolsky and the more experienced flight engineer Vladislav Volkov. To make matters worse, an electrical fire on June 16th forced Salyut 1 onto reserve power. Ground control insisted the station was safe, but the cosmonauts weren't convinced. They wanted to end the mission early. This sudden decision might have been something out of fear. Fear of something the Soviet government refused to acknowledge. However, they had no idea what was about to happen. Their highly anticipated space mission was about to turn into a nightmare. Known as the Tore Burke Recordings, a skilled team of international volunteers monitored Soviet transmissions throughout the 1960s. Their evidence suggests the Soviet Union covered up multiple deaths of cosmonauts drifting off into space. That fear may have been one of the reasons why the cosmonauts requested to leave, but ground control refused. The men stayed, continuing their experiments, and things quickly became much, much worse. Relentless stress and sleep deprivation took a toll on the crew. Most worrying was that Volkov, the most experienced man, grew irritable and started making critical mistakes. Over the next week, doctors kept a close watch on their declining mental state. However, their physical well-being was a growing concern. Daily exercise was vital in zero-gravity conditions to prevent muscle deterioration. But the treadmill rattled Salyut 1's solar panels and antennas, so they avoided using it throughout their stay. By June 24th, the exhausted crew had met their research goals, so ground control decided to end the mission 6 days early, planning to return on June 30th, 24 days after its launch, including their time in transit. The news instantly lifted the cosmonauts' spirits. After loading their research onto Soyuz 11, they powered up the spacecraft on June 29th and began preparing for their descent. During re-entry, the ship would separate into three compartments, the orbital, service, and descent modules. They were segmented using hatches and automatically ejected when 6 explosive bolts fired sequentially, or one at a time. It was into the extremely cramped descent module that the crew boarded, wearing minimal equipment to fit inside the small space. But when the time finally came to undock, Volkov struggled to seal the descent module hatch. With the help of ground control, he managed to tighten it just enough to pass a pressure test, and Dobrovolsky undocked Soyuz 11 at 18:28. It was supposed to be a straightforward leg home. Little did they know, something was about to go terribly wrong. At 22:35, Dobrovolsky ignited a retro rocket for 187 seconds, slowing the spacecraft for re-entry. 9 minutes later, at 105 miles altitude or 169 kilometers, Soyuz 11 started the separation sequence, but the explosive bolts malfunctioned, firing all at once. The cosmonauts had no warning. A violent blast jolted the descent module with extreme force, opening its pressure equalization valve by the slimmest margin. As alarms screamed, the cabin instantly lost 99% of its pressure, sucking air into space at over 600 miles or 965 kilometers per hour. The men turned off the module's radio transmitter and unstrapped from their seats, frantically trying to locate the hissing leak. But without pressure suits, their bodies were defenseless. Oxygen wrenched from their lungs and bloodstreams, causing their breathing rates to triple within 4 seconds. Each desperate gasp only worsened their suffocation, starving their brains of fuel. Soon, their neurons began to misfire, and nitrogen bubbles formed in their veins. They screamed in agony, twitching uncontrollably as stabbing pains tore through their joints. The sudden pressure drop ruptured blood vessels in their eyes and ears. Streaks of red trickled down their faces, and the men became deaf to the horror unfolding around them. Dizzy and confused, the cosmonauts tried to save themselves, but they were losing fluids. Moisture inside their eyes and mouths boiled, leaving a bubbling sensation on their tongues. Within 10 seconds of the blast, their vision blurred, tunneling into darkness. The last thing the cosmonauts saw was the cockpit fogging over. One by one, they lost consciousness, their hearts still beating erratically, struggling against severe internal bleeding. In the meantime, the world looked on with anticipation, expecting their triumphant return. When Soyuz 11 broke through Earth's atmosphere at 2347, its telemetry showed no visible damage. Mission Control thought it was only a matter of time before the cosmonauts resumed radio contact. However, they began to fear the worst as they tracked its progress beyond the usual blackout zone, where superheated plasma briefly cuts off signals. The module silently completed its automated descent, landing in central Kazakhstan 25 minutes later. Recovery personnel touched down shortly after and knocked on the module to give the cosmonauts a hero's welcome, but they didn't respond. The researchers opened the hatch, only to find vacant faces with dark blue patches staring back at them. Remarkably, Pastayev was found near the ventilation valve, whereas Dobrovolsky was tangled in his seat straps with a checklist nearby. Despite the devastating effects of decompression, they remained composed throughout it all. Dobrovolsky was still warm to the touch, so the recovery team immediately performed CPR on the crew. But it was too late. Their condition was reported to Mission Control using the coded message 111, a numerical health status system which meant fatal. The Soviet government transported their remains to the Burdenko Main Military Clinical Hospital for autopsies. The findings painted a grim picture. The cosmonauts had succumbed to asphyxiation. However, they also suffered hypoxia and catastrophic organ failure from blocked circulation. The Soviet Union broke the news a few hours later and held a state funeral in Moscow's Red Square on July 1st. But behind closed doors, engineers made a damning discovery. The cabin hadn't been tested for worst-case structural shocks, and its pressure valve was a known death trap. The mission's original commander, Alexei Leonov, didn't trust the valve to close automatically. He'd encountered issues in the simulator and advised the crew to close it manually, but it was buried beneath the cockpit seat, taking over a minute to close, 20 seconds longer than the crew survived. Without an emergency override or warning system, they never stood a chance. The Soviets covered up the design flaws to protect national pride. After 2 years of speculation, they finally revealed the truth to NASA during the 1973 Apollo-Soyuz project. In exchange, NASA shared their findings from the Apollo 13 disaster. The tragedy led to a complete redesign of Soyuz craft. Pressure valves were reinforced, emergency pressure equipment was added, and an accessible ventilation valve handle was installed in future cockpits. Most notable was mandatory pressure suits, a practice that saves lives to this day.